Ladies and gentlemen, once again, a very warm welcome to our reinvention laboratory. You've probably all seen me already this afternoon. For those who haven't, I'm Corinna Egra, and I have the great pleasure to be your host during this entire reinvention lab week. So now let's come to our second session of the day, of this week already, Work 4.0, the digital workplace. That is the topic of our session, and we will discuss the future of work, the future of our standardization work in the context of digitalization and a ever-changing challenges. And I think this is going to be a very interesting one more session. But before we start, let me explain another very interesting feature of the app that you have probably all downloaded, the general meeting app. So you've probably used it and come across an activity feed, a chronology of news, just like you know probably from Twitter, from Facebook, any other social media. You may all publish there. But if you do so, please limit to 140 characters and always add hashtag IECGM16 to your text. Then your message can be duplicated on social media pages directly. Well, in our connected world, everything is connected directly, so you can witness here when you post, and whatever you post is being published on the social media wall and also on the official general meeting webpage directly. So I hope we will see you all posting during this session, but let's go back to our session there, because there is not only an activity feed, I just commented on the main activity feed, but also every event has one. So you can use your smartphone, actually you can just put it out right now, and navigate to the Relab agenda. Some of you have done this before with the poll we did in the earlier session. And now select the session you're in, and then you have a horizontal menu, and you select the field activity you may post during this entire session. And anything you post right now in this session will be watched by editors and given to the moderator of the session and integrated into the discussion. And our editor today is Fabian Schrader, and he is sitting right here, so you know who is watching whatever you're writing. And with that, all the questions and answers are saved, not only for us in the sessions, but for the entire IEC community and for those who can follow whatever happens in the Reinvention Lab outside. So feel free to post all your comments from now on during the session until the end. Now, let's get started. I have the pleasure to introduce to you now the moderator, the host of this session. It is Carsten Hunger. Carsten, you can already come up here to stage. Welcome. Carsten, you are Standardization Manager at DKE German National Committee, responsible for German mirror committees for electrical equipment and systems for railways and for lightning protection. And you're also head of the VDE, the German Electrotechnical Association Competence Center, Smart Cities, and furthermore, organizing the German mirror committees for this topic. Is this right?
Right.
And then I've learned you're a project leader of the TC of the Future booth, which is right out there at this IEC general meeting.
That's all right.
Carsten, this is my introduction to you, and now the floor is all yours.
Thanks a lot. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, also from my side, a very warm welcome to all of you. Thanks, Corinna, for introducing me. My name is Carsten Hunger. And what we want to talk about today is this. That's right. You are right. That's not a digital workplace. But if you think about what was done in the past, mostly analog objects like this were transformed just into digital tools. And someone said at the end, OK, yes, we are digital now. But is it really so easy that just a pen and such paper digitalized, that is our digital workplace? Or is there also a change of mindset necessary in ourselves? These are some of the questions we want to answer in today's session within the Reinvention Laboratory. Nearly all of you are using these things today. In combination with a 25 years old idea named World Wide Web, it changed everything in our daily work life. Working on documents, wherever you are, sending them to colleagues around the world without any delay, that changed the whole process of standardization from the past into the future. But now we are facing new challenges. We have to be even faster, we have to be more flexible, and we have to be smarter than ever. So let's see how we can face these problems. Our speakers today will show us a mixture of experiences from existing projects up to visions for the future. After that, we will have a combined panel and plenary discussion. And like Corinna explained, you can send questions during the whole session. This is possible through our general meeting app, and Fabian will give these questions from your side to me, and we will have it in the plenary discussion, but also in the discussions right after the presentations of our speakers. But first of all, I have now the pleasure to welcome our first speaker, Ms. Michaela Wullinger. Hi, Michaela.
Hi, hello.
Michaela has been semiconductor engineer for more than 20 years, with profound experience in production and individual processes. Driven by her strong passion for innovation management, idea generation, and implementation, she offers various workshops on these topics, such as for innovative methodological expertise. In her adoptive home Dresden, the native Bavarian runs the region group of the German Association for Women's Engineers. Michaela, the floor is yours.
Oh, thank you. Welcome, everybody. I am here because not of my semiconductor experience, because I'm working for the so-called Deutsche Ingenieurinnenbund, a women's association, Women's Engineering Association Germany, and they are a small group of people, small group of women, but they can do a lot, and they have done a lot in the past, working with digital tools. Yes, that's why I want to explain at this example how powerful it is to work with digital tools if you are not sitting in one place. So I briefly introduce the Deutsche Ingenieurinnenbund, the women. This is the logo. I like to explain what they have done, what they are doing, and how they are doing. So they have the 30th anniversary this year, and they had a lot of publications, all made digital, not sitting in one place, but spread all over Germany. I have some examples. Maybe you can give a round. Unfortunately, they're all in German. They are only 40 members, 400 members. And 20 to 30 active people. So it's all always the same one. 400 members and active 20 to 30 women. And they have a project made in the past with a handful of people called, okay, top 25. And they have looked all over, thank you very much, all over engineering companies and found the top 25 most influential German engineers. And there's all with a handful of people. How are they doing this? Maybe you can have a look. You know, this is a web page. This is German talk, but it's printed out here. They are using all what the internet is offering. They are using Skype for video calling and chatting. I have written down them alternative. It's Google Hangout or Link. Or they're using Dropbox. If you want to share big files you don't want to send around, you can use Dropbox. Google Docs is new, and I worked in my company with Google Docs. Yes, there's one missing. Yes, and one step back. All these presentations are made with a wiki, so-called wiki. This is, you can sit at home, or at a bar, or a coffee place, and now I drop down, and everyone knows what to do. So when I want to have an article there, I email or call or chat with my magazine leader and say, I want to make an article. I put it there, download the latest version, and note down, oh, this is one I need to lecture. And once it's fixed, it's done. And there, this whole magazine that's going around is made by all virtual places that we never meet. We sit one in Bavaria, one in Saxonia, and we never meet. And what I like to show you with some people is how Google Docs may work. Maybe is somebody here who has worked already with Google Docs? Yes? Okay, great. I like Google Docs. I'm a Google paranoia, let me say. I don't like this Google because it knows everything about you, but I like Google Docs and I like working with Google Docs because it's easy to access. You just need a Google account. You can work on the same sheet as group at once. We show you later how it works. It's automatically saved. You never get lost because your connection is lost or your power is empty. It's always saved. This is great. Then everyone has the same status. I don't know if you have experienced, you're working on a sheet, sending around, and you never know, is this the latest version? Somebody else has made changes and you never know. This is at Google Sheets. You have a history tracking. You know who has written what every time. The only disadvantage I can face is that you need a Google Doc account. You can't work without. Okay. I need now the other one. I have two colleagues here who are helping me. I will show. Oh, you can't read it. What you see, I have prepared a Google Docs account, and what you see here is I can see everyone who's working simultaneously with me. I see who is looking at my documentation. And now I have to have a look how I can make this better. Ich will nicht gerade, wie ich es größer machen kann. It's all right, okay. And now you see the colors, a purple one. This is Kerstin, and I can see here, this is Dirk, and that's myself. And you see with the colors, Dirk is the pink one, and I see where he's working on. The first time I did experiences that everyone can work in on the same time, it's a little bit scary, but then you know who is working on this. And I now add something here. Video call, telephone. And though you can even tell your messages. And I never have to press save. And what I can see here, one moment. You can see here the history. I can see whatever one has taken. So if you say, oh, this is not my comments, this is not my sheet, you can even restore and see who has made what. You know everything, and you can track everything. And you need to share this document. You have here a link, and if you want somebody to take care or to edit this one, you can share it. You can share it even just only to read it or to edit. This is here. This is unfortunately in German. But here I can give rights, share rights, edit rights, everything. Just read. Okay. I just want to give you a brief expression what you can do with Google Sheets, and at the I am the end. Do you have questions? I think this is a little bit much because of the inertia, but go to Google Sheets. Are there questions?
Okay. Thanks a lot, Michaela, for the great insight of your collaborative work with your group there. It's now time for a short question answering. So we've seen there's no question during the activity feed, but you can also send it now. Or you can also question or send questions now directly via your voice to Michaela. So are there any questions? Not directly. OK. So just I have one. experiencing all these online tools, do you think in the future physical meetings will be still necessary in our daily work life?
This is a yes, but not so often. I think you need, sometimes you need, maybe at the beginning of a project or in the middle, but not so often.
It's OK. Okay, but you in your daily life with your group are not meeting each other, or do you have one meeting a year, or?
We have one meeting a year. I know some of my colleagues.
Okay.
Some of these members of the engineering board, I knew some, and that's sufficient.
Okay.
When I was working on the project, I meet once in the beginning, and then I did not meet them.
Sounds really like a digital workplace for you, because. Normally, we as standardization organizations know a lot of meetings, often sometimes for working groups and so on. But even also in standardization organizations, we have already some virtual meetings. a second question I have is, was everyone in your team convinced right from the beginning on from working completely online? Because sometimes people have such a natural hurdle to jump over until?
This is a good question, and is the answer is no.
Really?
No, it's some of us are really keen to these technologies, and I love this because I can work on the sheet when my kids are sleeping, and I have a lot more flexibility because this is all after my standard work, and I can do this whenever I want to. Not meetings or conferences call, but I can do all this sheet stuff when I have time to. Some of the elder ones are a little bit reluctant.
Okay.
But the younger ones are growing up with this stuff.
Okay, thanks a lot. Yeah. Last chance now. Are there any questions to Michaela? Okay, thanks a lot again for your presentation. Yeah. And we will see you again in some minutes for the panel discussion. So, no, you can leave it here. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Working in the digital world, our next speaker has a passion for this. Mr. Christian Marxreiter is a successful IT businessman and serial entrepreneur. In May 2013, he founded the Smart Work Solutions GmbH, developing a web-based intelligent word processing platform, which facilitates online collaboration on documents by allowing the users concurrent writing, editing, and reviewing. Prior to stirring up the market of traditional word processing solutions, such as Word and Google Docs, he founded several other successful IT businesses, including the online platform for deposit guarantees, Deutsche Kautionskasse, the world's first collaboration platform for the industrial insurance branch, in INEX24 AG, and the Institute for Payment Security. My warm welcome to Christian, and the floor is yours.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you. Hi. Good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to show you a little bit about the future of document collaboration. So, what is document collaboration? Can this work? Or did I take the wrong one? Ah, now we go. So what is document collaboration? Typically a situation where a lot of people working on the same document, right? But if you ask these people, it's not feeling like that. It's more like this. Ah. A lot of versions, a lot of change requests, a lot of You agree? You know the situation. But this is really a nasty, it's not fun. It's really a mess. It's a mess of versions, of changes, of emails, of comments, of private notes, right? But what is really the problem? Well, it's not a problem if this guy is writing a document. So that's his final version. No problem. Just open Word or Google Docs. And then it's not a problem to share this document with other people. You can use a SharePoint, a Dropbox, or you send it out by email. But at the moment when these guys start to edit the document, so like this, they add something, they delete something, they create more and more versions and comments and email, then you feel like this, right? If this is a document with 100 pages and you have 23 versions, so you have to manage 2,300 pages, which is mostly copies. Totally ridiculous system. But it comes from a time when it was about replacing a typewriter, right? Do you know when Microsoft Word was born? 1986, 30 years ago. So no wonder why it feels like that, right? The second really big problem is and you see the version confusion. Everyone has these kind of folders, huh? Funny names for your documents, like final, review, 01, Stephanie's comments, really final. Yeah? That's not easy. The second biggest problem is what's been changed. So every time when I get, or you get a new version of a document, there's just this question to answer. So what's been changed? So the clock is ticking, and what you typically do is you compare it with the previous version that you know, which is creating even more versions, called the compare versions, and you start proofreading. And this is one of the reasons why desks are so big. So you print it out, and you start proofreading, right? This is just wasting time. Now you would say there are a lot of tools outside, right? So there are tools for writing, there are tools for sharing, versioning, creating documentation, there are tools for communicating, there are tools for tracking changes. And some people have an interesting strategy. They are combining tools, right? So you have a word processor, and you have something where you can do the versioning, and a sophisticated Outlook email solution, a super fancy chat solution, and a super professional track changes solution. But honestly, it's not really solving the problem. And it's also not solving the problem if you exchange the tools. If you exchange Word by Office 365, if you exchange your SharePoint by Box, or if you exchange your Outlook by Gmail, it's all the same, just with a different name, right? So this is a dead-end situation. What do you do typically in a dead-end situation? You do not continue. You restart from scratch. You reimagine everything. Everything means that we have to sit down and understand where the problems are and how we can solve these problems with modern technology. So that's what we did. And one of the reasons why it's not working is because we as the users have to do the work. We have to manage these freaking versions. We have to find out what's changed. It's a very simple answer. Turn the tables. Let the documents do the work. Hey, we are in 2016. We can create intelligent document, which is not a Word document or a Google Docs document. Right? These are just replacement for typewriters. What I am talking about is intelligent documents which do the work for us. So what's the difference? Speaking about version control. So typically you have 50, 100, or 200 versions of one and the same document if it's a real big process that you have to do. So, but in an intelligent document, you have just one single document. There are no more versions. So if you take a look at this document, you see these little labels by the side, these ones. They are indicating you that there's something happened in the past. And if you want to see the history to every section of your document, it's just a click on these labels. And what you now will see is a quick video where I just click on these labels. So the system explains me and shows me the history to every of these sections, right? To this section, this one. There's even a history for this image. These are the previous versions of the image. And this is the history of the table. It's all packed in one single document. There are no more 50 versions. There's one document which is intelligent and which remembers every change perfectly to every paragraph, every picture, and every table in your document. Second, how to understand easier and faster what's been changed? Well, the easiest way, if I don't have, is I don't have to care about that because the document knows who you are. The document knows who you are, so if you open the document like I do right now, I get a notification. And the intelligent document is not looking the same for everyone. Because you were on vacation for 14 days, you were working 15 minutes ago on the document. So if you are opening the document, you may have missed one or two changes. If you are opening the document, you may have missed 200 changes. And an intelligent document knows what you've missed automatically. So what you do is open the document, see there is a notification, click on this notification icon. These are the sections which have news for me, and the news are highlighted in yellow. So what I right now do is I track the changes. Imagine this is a 200 pages document. I was quickly on the toilet for 15 minutes, coming back. See, there are seven sections with changes, and now I'm tracking them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and here's my table, a change in the table, and 7. And this is working in real time. So the difference to Google Docs, I love Google Docs, but not for this kind of work, right? Is that you understand what other people do. It's always funny to see if people are writing at the same page. I never do this. If I have a 100 pages document, I don't see what my colleagues are writing on page 90. But here, I understand because the document knows. Did you ever freak out with Word trying to format a really perfectly designed document? Consistent numbering? Yeah? This is not a problem with an intelligent document. It's one click, and the document is producing a perfect layout. You don't have to freak out again because it's doing it automatically. And for you guys, very, very interesting, in every kind of format and data structure. So of course you can get a Word document or a PDF, but you can also get an XML file, so what you save in your database or in a CMS system. You could produce an EPUB, or you could produce an InDesign file if you want to produce a book or something like that. That is what an intelligent document is able to do. And at last, a very important thing. Everything that you're writing in an intelligent document is content that you can reuse. If you write in a traditional word processor, like in Google Docs or in Word, it's just a virtual piece of paper and no one knows what's going on. But if you manage the content like this, if every single paragraph, every single picture, and every single table is an object in the database, but it feels like writing a normal document, right? That's the magic. Then you can reuse this content. You can ask the database, where is this picture, and did you use it in other documents? And the database can answer this question. To bring it to one sentence, intelligent documents enable to work you super efficient. We have customers like the Bitkom or the VDE or Digital Europe, which is the European Association for IT Companies, and they're saying it's so much easier and it's up to 10 times faster than before. Intelligent documents are the future of document collaboration. Well, actually, not true. they are reality. And the product behind intelligent documents is called Smash Docs. If you would love to see it, just give it a try outside. There's a demo booth, so where you can see with two monitors what's going on if you work on an intelligent document. And everyone can do this, by the way. There are some guys in VDE already working on intelligent documents, but now this system is open for everyone, and you can just go to vde.smashdocs.net and register for free and enjoy super efficient document collaboration. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Christian. That was a really interesting insight. The booth, he said, it is the TC of the future booth right outside of this hall here. So yeah, we will be happy to see you there. As the next presentation will be directly connected with this topic, we will move directly on to the next speaker. And all your questions, maybe you have asked now through the activity feed or you have now in your mind, will be kept for the panel and plenary discussion afterwards, after our next speakers. And yeah, keep it in your head, and you can ask it later on the panel and plenary discussion. I'm happy now to introduce Dominik Nieck as our next speaker. You can come up, yeah.
Thanks.
Dominik is Technical Manager Standards in DKE since 2 years, and elaborates new methods of standardization and commentation. He's responsible for the German Mirror Committee for Operation of Electrical Installations and is member of the IEC SMB Ad Hoc Group 67 TC and SC Minutes Trial. Dominik,
thank you.
The floor is yours.
Thank you. Yes. Today, I want to tell you something about online standardization. We could also call it computer-supported collaborative standardization work. That's a really educational name. I explain it to you. Yeah. So, today I want to tell you three things, or show you three things. I want to show you the current situation in the standardization work. I want to tell you our motivation and our objectives for a change. And I want to tell you the requirements and a new process for that. Yeah. Maybe some of you know all these documents you see on the slides. This is our current IEC standardization process. It's simplified, so let's start on the left side with an idea. You have an idea and you want to produce a new standard, and you send it to the IEC, to a technical committee, and they create a new work item proposal, a new document, and share it on the collaboration tool. At the national committees, they use that document, discussing and write some comments and make a vote. And they start working, and they send it back to the national committee, send them back to the IEC, and so on. You have many emails, you have many documents in this process, and it's really boring to you need a long time to get a ready international standard. So let's show another picture. So let's start on the left side down. We have a document, and we share it with the community via a collaboration tool. Many national committees share it with their own collaboration tool. You see our German collaboration tool left up. The experts download their documents from there and editing it at home. And they're writing, and the best thing is, I think, they write comments in a table in a Word document. Why? After that, they meet in and discuss their comments, put it together, write it in a document, and send it back to IEC. And you go many times through that circle until you have a final standard. And to answering this question, no, it's not. It's time for the next step of standardization, or for the next evolution. The evolution before, I told you, I want to tell you, was the email, because we don't have to use the postal service. So, yeah, our motivation. Yeah, we want to write standards more fast, more collaboratively. We want better quality of the content. And we want a better collaboration between the IEC, the experts, between all stakeholders together. And yeah, our objectives for that are standards should be written in one document together and online. The process should be easier, that new experts, young professionals, can easier join to the standardization work. Young professionals are our future, and they came to the IEC community, and we have complex processes, and yeah, we should change that. Yeah. So we think about writing or creating standards in one document, and how could that look like? Someone of you has an idea. And starts at home, writing on his notebook, writing some sentences, and gets more and more better, some more sentences, and he thinks that's a good idea or a good draft for a standard. And he sends it to a friend, maybe you can look like, and is it good? Or so he not send it, he share it. He shared with a friend. And maybe they are together, think it's okay, it's good. Okay, let's discuss it in the group. So they share the document in the community, in the technical committee or in the work group. And in the work group, they are creating new sentences and creating new, and discuss all that and making comments. And maybe you're able to export this draft as a comedy draft. And after the you collect all these comments, you can put these comments back to the document. So in the current situation. But let's think in the future. Maybe standards not in a document, or standards are not a document, standards are in a database. So if you work in one document, you could put this document in a database, and the standard is in the database. So this is one system, and you use all this system. And for this system, or for this type of or kind of creation, we think we should create a better or a new process, because our process is so complex. And we analyze our process and ask us which steps are really necessary. And we think we only need three phases to develop a standard or to have a standard. The first thing is elaboration. We discuss a standard, we have a paper, and we discuss it on one document in a platform. We elaborate, we get comments, we get change requests, and we work there. If necessary, we can export one document at a defined time for national drafts. Many national committees have to make a national draft, so it's an important type of standardization work. So. Yeah, and they can play this or give that comments from the national committees back. You are elaborating. Sometimes you have to make a poll. And if the document is good enough, you freeze it. You do some final editing. You make a vote with the national committees. And after that, you publish this document as an international standard. And after that, you get a stability phase. But this is not the end. At the end of the first elaboration phase, you start the elaboration for the second edition. Yeah. So let's talk about our requirements. To do that, we identified many requirements for a tool and for that work. So I want to explain three of these. The important one is collaboration. We all should work together in one document and at the same time. For standardization work, also important is editing and commenting. And very important is the usability. Every user should be able to use new tools with a lesson less than 1 hour. That's usability. And we choose a tool for our pilot experiments. That's SmashDocs. Thank you to Mr. Marxreiter. We choose it. We collecting experience. We make tests. And we hope this tool will be one of the solutions for the future. So let's make a short resume. We have many pros with this work. Small and mid-sized companies, experts, and countries with a lower travel budget can easier participate. This is the chance to get more experts to the developing process from standards. So standards will be developed together, and standards will be more clarity, and the developing process will be more transparent. And we can use a collaborative text editor for using the current process, for the current IEC process, or we can use it with a new process. We have also some risks. One of them is the acceptance of the experts. But we want to eliminate it with an early involvement and the pilot projects. And so we want to have them with us, not against us. And the other risk is that national committees and the IEC will develop own solutions, and we have many solutions around the world. That will be not as good because the experts want one tool for all the standardization work. So, yeah. I can only repeat it. Please visit us at the TC of the Future booth right there and join to our pilot project. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Dominik. Thanks a lot. Normally, we didn't want to have a question answering, but now there was one question currently coming into the activity feed, and I don't want to shift it to the plenary discussion. So I will go directly to Fabian, and he can read it.
Hello, everyone. I think you see the question also there. Yep. The question is, how can we accelerate the finding of a consensus? Because if you have seen, there is a huge potential to improve productivity. So the question is, how can we accelerate this, and how can we get to this point?
With this tool, we have the chance to comment, or the possibility to comment, to make comments, and to discuss. So we discuss in the document, and we have to include a poll function. At the moment, we don't have this poll function, but we have to include such poll functions, and so we can find a consensus with discussions and with polls, like we also do it only in meetings.
Okay, thanks a lot, Dominik. We will hear each other again in some minutes for the plenary and panel discussion, so thanks a lot, first of all.
Thank you.
So, some of you may took the train to come here to Frankfurt this day or yesterday. For example, also these guys from Germany. During my daily work as a standardization manager, I'm traveling a lot with the train and working in the train. So, my workplace is not only digital, so my laptop, it's also moving through the whole of Germany. So, although this is not the topic now, this leads me to our next speaker. Maybe come here into. Oh, yeah. Oh, sorry. I haven't seen you. So, This is our next speaker. This is Kim Elo. Kim is a standardization expert for the aerospace, valves, and rail industry. Prior to joining Bombardier Transportation in Germany, he worked for German Institute for Standardization, DIN, so he has a background also as standardization manager, and organized various European and international technical committees and working groups. So, Kim, happy to have you here, and the floor is yours again.
Yes, thank you very much, Carsten. Hello, everybody, good afternoon. And I'm here today to talk about standardization, of course. It's the reinvention laboratory for standardization. And I would like to introduce to you the effect the digital workplace may have on the standardization. And there are a couple of questions that we or statements that we always hear about standardization. And one of them is standardization is rather a dull business. And the funny thing is that when I talk to my friends and family and they say, oh, where do you work, standardization? So they don't think this is such a, such a hip and innovative field. But when I tell them what I do, they are always very astonished. And they rethink about standardization as a pretty cool business, actually. Another statement that we hear is that standardization takes way too long, because if you figure we have about 3 years until the standardization process should be complete, a lot changes in 3 years, and also the requirements that you may have in the beginning, and so this is like a very, very long period of time. On the other hand, people say, the standardization institutes, they shorten the commenting periods, for example, or the time frame for developing standards. So, and especially in my position at Bombardier Transportation right now, we're trying to gather a consolidated company opinion, and we are faced with a very, very big challenge, and that is getting this opinion formed in just this short period of commenting. So there's a really big contradiction between those two statements. Another one is standardization is too expensive. People have to pay for the standards. Why is it not for free? And then one core statement is we're not getting what we need. We as standard users, we need something that we can use right away rather than having to transfer it. And I will talk about this in a couple of minutes. So the standardization system today is, it's a relatively straightforward system. We have certain rules, of course, and a time frame, which you can see here on the screen. And there's several internal regulations, for example. And they give you a set of rules that you have to obey in order to develop standards. And the question is it too rigid? Do we need something more flexible? For example, a more flexible time frame. And because right now you can see we have a lot of time where the standard is just sitting around. Nothing really happens with it. And that's the light blue areas. Maybe it's better to see here. That is time where, for example, the European and the international standardization organizations, they do editing and things like that. And the question I come to later is that really a necessary period? Can we shorten this maybe? And the dark blue areas is something that we may need to handle more flexibly because we may need more time. Sometimes we need less time, and we could, progress faster if we wouldn't have to be in this tight concept. Sometimes if you have larger documents, of course, you need a longer time frame than the one that is given. But sometimes you can be a lot faster. And a very provocative statement is, do we need a time frame at all? Can't we just work, the way we work and then proceed with the results? Or do we really have to stick to a time frame? Then we come to certain deliverables that we have. Of course, we have standards, we have technical specifications and technical reports, just to name them a little bit. And those documents, they come in a certain format. You know, I mean, you see here, I've taken some screenshots, and these are PDF files. And so the problem is that the wrong format? I mean, for example, us at Bombardier Transportation, it is nice to have the PDF, but we can't really do anything with it. You know, we have certain tools that we feed with the content of those standards, but the problem is we can't do this right away with a PDF. We can't just take the PDF and put it in our systems. So what we do is we have the PDF document, which is for us a almost useless format. Then what we do is we put people to work and they scan the document. They scan it for requirements, which we have to fulfill. They, well, easy spoken, they copy and paste the requirements and put it in a standardization, not in a standardization system, but in a requirements management system. We at Bombardier, we use Doors. Other companies use the same. So the problem is we do this, company B does it too, and you know what? Company C is doing the same thing. So all the companies we're paying for the document, which we cannot use. We put people to work to do the same work in every company. And this is something like this. So one key solution would be if you had a standard, which is contains, for example, 10 requirements. And then you have your user, which is, for example, me. And this guy, he only needs a couple of requirements for each from each standard. You know, he doesn't need the complete standard, but only a few things here and there. And why not make him pay only for what he needs? So then he needs only those 5 requirements, and yeah, he would be a happy guy. Another thing is the way standards are developed today, which you can see on the screen here. It's I don't really want to say it's an old-fashioned way of collaborating, but you know, you have to travel places, you meet people, and you discuss with them. You come to a consensus, hopefully, and then you send out the document. It's getting, you know, everybody can vote on it and comment on it. And then the results of those comments, or the comments actually, they get transferred back to the committee, and, you know, they come together again, they meet, they discuss. And so in the end, you have a document. But this is, you know, rather lengthy process, and it involves a lot of traveling and a lot of money, and this is something companies never have. So we were looking for maybe a process that is more modern, maybe. And so maybe we could do a combination of both, you know, have physical meetings and have people there on a virtual basis, and people draft the requirements, what they want to have in the standards, and they draft this not in Word format like we used to do. And I mean, working for Dean, I used to do a lot of editing and Word formatting and things like that, and the whole document gets shot to hell. And we had some fun with that. And maybe it would be a lot easier if you could just, you know, type it in no format at all, and put this into a magic miracle machine, and they this machine automatically produces what you need, a standard with the requirements that you can just, you know, pick as you need them. And there's also a little bit of further criticism that we may find in standardization, and one probably is related to the Industry 4.0 aspect. Why do we distinguish between electrotechnical standardization and mechanical standardization? So this, you know, could be something that could be combined, not everywhere, you know, but in certain places where the mechanic world and the electrotechnical world are, connected. We have seen that the standards developing organizations, they have sometimes different processes here and there. Stage codes is just one example that we think should be harmonized, but in fact, they are not always harmonized. Then another issue is the language versions. You translate for every stage, for the inquiry stage, for the formal vote stage, and the question is that really needed, or do we? Yeah, maybe we can only use the translation at the very end of the document. Of course, we have certain obligations to provide inquiry documents in the native language, but maybe this can be changed. And then the last question is the cost of standardization and the standards, actually. I know why standards are not for free, because I worked for a standards producing organization, but maybe this is something that we can think about in the future. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Kim, for your presentation. I think also here's a quick, short, and answering potential. I have one question here on the activity feed, but I will think we will shift this to the plenary discussion, because this is quite near to one of the questions we have already prepared for this. So I think there's nothing more, right? Okay, perfect. But I have one. Just one question. What I also, a standardization manager, often here is faster, faster, faster. That's what a standardization process should be. Do you agree?
To a certain degree. As I've just talked about, in a company, we are faced with so many employees, and they all are experts in their different fields, and if you have a inquiry version of a standard, a draft standard, you try to allocate this to the right person and try to get feedback from them, technical feedback, of course. And sometimes it's not so easy to establish this in such a short time. So sometimes we wish for longer commenting periods, but at the same time, when we are, when we are okay with the content of a standard, we say, okay, well, we could just, proceed. So it is a trade-off.
Okay. Thanks a lot again for your presentation. And now I want to have you all back on the plenary for the plenary and panel discussion here, right on. Hopefully all our speakers are still here. Okay, maybe we can be around here a bit. Now it's also for you the opportunity. I will give, first of all, a first question to all of our speakers here. But afterwards, you all can also show your question up. And I will also take this activity feed question later on. So, but let me first start. We have now seen a lot different things. So first of all, some guys who are not really involved in standardization things, but have a digital workplace all around in Germany. And we went completely through the whole standardization process, deeply into the standardization process through the whole session here. So everyone has seen here now the idea of online standardization, such like with Google or with Smashdocs, and also some things here in having processes a bit different. For some of them, they are also they were included in some projects here, and some are not. What features do you regard as key for the successfully for the success in the future for online standardization? So I will ask all of you. So maybe Michaela, as you, as not non-standardization expert, maybe you have an idea for this.
I'm a fan of the smart docs. Smart docs. Sorry for that. And I found intelligent documents are so great. And I think this is one would help everyone, not standardization, but everyone to see where I am, what are these key changes, and not to track down 101 features, and okay. be online all the time. Yeah.
Thank you. Christian.
I'm absolutely not a standardization specialist. Okay. But what I have understood out of the work that we do in this pilot project that you guys are creating a lot of content, right? And you have a lot to discuss. And so if there is a system which is helping you, which is guiding you through the process to understand what has changed and to manage the conversations, I'm very convinced that this will fasten your process extremely. We see this in other projects, for example, like for the Bitkom, when they use it for positioning papers, when 35 people discuss very heavily on a position paper, which has 30 to 50 pages. And it's really faster because you can work at the same time. And if you don't do it, you need just a few minutes to track the new changes. So I think that could be very helpful, especially also for reusing the content. So if you wrote the content, is what you said, then you can reuse it because it's saved in a database and you can decide what you do with this content, and how you produce it.
Okay.
Yeah. The reuse, sorry for jumping in, the reuse aspect is something really important for us because, you know, in standardization you have certain definitions, for example, and those definitions, you know, they should be the same for the same thing. You know, it's best not to have like two or three different types of definitions for one exact same thing. And this is something that we experienced in standardization as well, that we in fact did have such ambiguous definitions. And if we had a database, you know, we could just grab what's in the database and put it back in the standard. And as we prefer, you know, we would like to have this online so that our colleagues, you know, if they are sitting in the office, they could, you know, maybe log on and see, right now they're working on this and that, and so they could probably also give some feedback in real time.
Okay, so
last
Dominic.
Answer.
Last answer.
Yeah, I think two things are important. The first thing is work together in one document at the same time, collaborative. And the second thing is the usability. You get more and more different tools for every different work you have. And for each tool, you need many lessons to learn it. And but you all know how to use a Word program and to use text editors. And so use that knowledge and create a tool that is easy to learn and easy to use. And we all and create a tool that we all know to use. Yeah.
Okay. So now it's the time. Coming back to the question from the activity feed, and now it's a complete new format also for me. Chris Andrews asks, or he said, I have two concerns. One is sociological. Sorry, my English. The second second is derived me from the working of my own maintenance team, where there is a great reluctance to consider matters between meetings and strong disagreements rather than regular consensus. Maybe we can also, who may answer this, is there also a possibility with digital work and digital collaboration to solve this problem? If you do not have the question right now, you can also look at the activity feed again. Maybe Kim, as a standardization expert also.
Yeah, I want to
read it again,
sorry,
no
I
problem.
Just read this once.
Just
time.
No yeah. problem, no problem.
Yeah. Oops.
Ah.
I will just
we have another question, right here. Yes, here. There are some things coming into. Maybe in between, or do you have
no,
already?
Just go ahead.
Okay, but no, maybe you have the answer before, because I will otherwise switch the topic. Do you have any opinion on this or not?
Yeah, it's a. I don't know. Yeah, it's a. Not really sure what to say about it. It's really a sociological aspect, and yeah, consensus of course is reached in those committees, hopefully. And so if it's not, then you know, you you just keep going in circles and circles, and that really prolongs the system, the development process as well. So
So maybe we can also come back to this what I asked Michaela before, because I think these sociological challenges we have with these digital tools. Sometimes I also experienced that sometimes physical meetings can solve problems which you had before on digital discussions and so on. And when you meet these people afterwards, drinking some beer and, in the evening, some problems will be solved. Do you think these things will, or these tools, will change also the meeting culture, so that maybe these making easier things are not there in the future if you cut physical meetings out? Maybe Christian.
Well, out of our experience, it's always a combination.
Okay.
So technology is just there to support you, to make the things easier. But I think, I know this from the associations which are working with our solutions. They transfer a lot of the discussions before they meet. And they are not, they don't have to meet virtually. So they set up their comments and there is some conversations going on. We've seen documents where we have up to 5,000 comments in one document, which is around 80 to 100 pages. It's a lot. Right, but it's really interesting that more and more people commit up front, and then they start to focus. A lot of things are discussed before the meeting starts, and maybe are closed. But when they meet and they have their gremiums, they pick out, every party is picking out their 10 most important questions or comments. And then they really sit together and they present these comments and they see what the discussion was before. So the technology is just there to deliver the data which happened before, and to make for everyone it easier to understand what happened before and to come to a better decision. And of course, alcohol is always a super problem solver at the end of the day.
So I'm happy there will be also some physical meetings also in the future. I'm happy about this, because sometimes it's also necessary to know all these people around.
Yeah, it's especially important for alliance buildings, so to say. No? If you need support from somebody else, or if you just need somebody to talk to, you know, who's in the same business with you, who has the same problem, then you can come to a solution together. And I have experienced that as well, that, you know, sometimes you talk and talk and talk, and then you have a coffee break, and then suddenly, you know, you come up with a solution and everybody's happy about it. So with all the virtual meetings, I think that still in the future, we cannot get rid of physical meetings.
Okay, that's then a smart a meeting or a smart workplace there in a meeting. This was now a bit more plenary discussion, a panel discussion. So maybe I can also, I hope there will be some questions from the plenary here, from our experts around. Are there any questions? Ah, there, up there. So maybe I can.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Yeah, Kim, you will answer something.
There's nothing more to add. I mean, obviously, I've worked, you know, with this kind of tool, and I mean, you know, once you work with it, you get used to it. But you're right. I mean, with all this change tracking, and then sometimes it's hard to transport this to other people, and sometimes they don't really know how to use it, the change tracking feature and everything. So, yeah, it is sometimes hard to work with Word, and then you know you have templates in Word, which the standardization institutes use. And sometimes this template, you know, it, I don't know, it gets destroyed. You know, if you do something weird with it, it gets destroyed. And then you have to reformat the whole document. And I've done that many times. And yeah, it's sometimes hard.
Working in a standardization organization, I know you can do everything with a Word document to destroy it. So there are a lot of different ideas to destroy it. I know it already. So a second question, what I have from my side. Also, there are maybe other plenary. Yeah, there, sure.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I also would like to congratulate the organizers for this very, very interesting session. I'm the Director General of SEN and SENELEC. And I have a question also for the gentleman from Bombardier, because he said no time frame at all. We are giving a lot of thoughts to precisely to timeliness in the standardization process. Don't you think that it could be useful that those that are contributing to the standards making process define the time in which they would like to have the standard available, rather than to leave it absolutely open? It could take forever.
Exactly.
And what would be the added value of having a standard that is never developed or made it available? So I would like to hear your opinion on that. Also, regarding the collaborative approach and the intelligent documents, I mean, we heard a lot, and I'm convinced that we need to go through a transformation on how we work, how we make consensus, to get more people engaged. Do we need to have also some consensus on the tool that we need to use? Because there is a zoo out there of different tools that we can actually use, and that could engage more stakeholders, but also pull back some of the current stakeholders that we have and make very valuable contributions. So what would be the advice in that respect?
Yeah, I'm not sure if I can give you advice, but just some ideas, you know. I mean, if you have a time frame that's not really a time frame, that is open, that is flexible, you know, people in the committees and in the working groups, they could decide for themselves how fast they need the standard. Of course, everybody is participating in those working groups and committees to achieve something, you know, and it's in nobody's interest to achieve something in 15 years. So that really takes too long. But sometimes, you know, you need periods that are longer than 3 years to develop a standard, because, you know, you're starting from scratch and everything, and you have a very controversial topic maybe. And so you just need more time. And sometimes, you know, if you're in this tight time frame, you risk of getting the project being deleted. You know, and then you have to reapply for it, and you know, I mean, there's a whole complex process behind it. So maybe if we had something more open, you know, if people need, let's say, 18 months to prepare the draft, okay, let them have 18 months. If they need only 2 months because they have done a lot of preparatory work before, okay, let them have 2 months, and then send SENELEC Management Center takes over, you know, because they also need, of course, time for editing and making sure everything is all right. So and they surely need this time as well, and because we as users we want products that are, you know, that are well developed. And regarding your comment on the tools, of course, we need something that is equal throughout IEC and ISO and SEN-SENELEC, because I've stressed the fact that harmonized stage codes are not so harmonized. I've seen that, when I was working for Dean, I was more involved in the SEN and ISO system. And I've just now immersed into the IEC system. And suddenly I was faced with harmonized stage codes, which I've never seen in my entire life before. So I was trying to figure out where they relate to the stage codes that I have known from my former life. And I've come to the conclusion you need, you know, like a mapping table or so. And it would have been much easier if we had the stage codes harmonized. And why do we need those stage codes? Because we have a tool inside our company that scans for those stage codes. And if you have nothing to scan for, you're lost. So that's why it would be cool for us to have harmonized stage codes across all levels.
Okay, thanks. There is another question I've seen here. Okay.
Yeah, question from your back. Jochen Friedrich, head of standardization for Europe for IBM. So first of all, also from this side, a thumbs up. Yeah, you have now from all sides support. I think especially Kim's presentation is the right level of disruptive thinking we need for standardization to become more agile, more responsive to the different paces that are needed. I'm in full support. Now, for using collaborative editing, I have one question and one concern. The question is, if we have these sort of modern tools, etc., I believe we still need to be able to extract something like the comments, which are the comments, from who are they, for doing sometimes a proper comment resolution discussion. If you have them all somewhere in the document, it can work, but if you have them on a database, excuse me, should be easy to extract to do this. And you mentioned that the comments, you want to introduce a polling mechanism for the comments. And here I have a concern that goes a bit along this discussion about consensus. Isn't there a risk that if we do polling all the time, it drives us away from consensus into more polling, which we may not want in standardization, but to keep the basic principle of consensus, which sometimes may need longer than having a quick and easy poll, more discussion. I think we need to keep this in mind when we look at the tools we use and how we use them. Thank you.
I think I will hand it over.
Yes, of course. I'm fully with you. Polling should not be the first solution or the first thing to do. So at the moment, we discuss, we write comments, when they meet, we discuss, and we discuss more. And the last thing, if we don't find a consensus, we make a poll. And we could do this in the future. So we discuss at the document, we make comments, discuss in the document, and if we don't find a solution, or let's make a web conference. Let's start the web conference, maybe out of the tool, out of the document, discuss it in the web conference, and if you're not able to find a solution there, then you have to do the worst case scenario, you have to make a physical meeting. Or you use the function and make a poll. This should not be the first thing you do. You should do it after discussions. And so you need a moderator in the process. And if you think we don't find a solution or a result in the discussion, okay, we have to make a poll. But then we activate the poll function. The poll function is not at the beginning, or should not be at the beginning.
I'd love to add something to, sure, to the comments. As I said, we've seen a document with 5,000 comments. So, really true. So, but it's only possible to handle this huge number of comments if you qualify them. So these are four people from Siemens and three people from Caterpillar and whatever it is. So they can filter out their comments, for example. They are topic related, so they are referring to the same section in the document, so you can collect them. As you correctly said, it's saved in a database, so what I'm talking about is reporting. So say, okay, in this specific 10 paragraphs, give me all the comments. And then if you start qualifying them, you don't have this feature, but it's available, by the way. So you can configure the dialogue. You can say, this is a high priority. This is super urgent. This is just a comment to a typo. Or this is a technical comment. So you can qualify these comments. And that's what these guys are doing in preparing their meetings. They do a lot of conversations up front, but then they start to qualify, and then they pick up the 10 really most important ones and come to a very, very valid conversation. So that's why if we're talking about comments, please do not think of that simple commenting feature that you see in Google or in Word. It's a sophisticated commenting feature where you really can do this intensively.
Thanks a lot. So coming a bit nearly to the end, but we can see the end already. I would love to know from our non-standardization experts here in our panel, what do you think is the biggest obstacle for the implementation of such a tool like this or other tools within our digital workplace in the future?
Well, it works best if everyone really works with it. So if you have a group of 30 people and 10 people are not willing to work, then every online tool will not work. That's a very simple thing. I can just say, be open-minded. Some things are a little bit different, what you expect. And one of the biggest challenges that we see is that it can do so much more what you wouldn't expect. If you would take a look at the solution, you would say, okay, it's another Google Docs, but it's not the truth, right? So be open-minded and give it a try and see the benefits. And again, if you have a group and there are people which are definitely not willing to work, no collaboration solution, online collaboration solution will really work. Okay. That's a huge risk.
True.
But this is what we have to work on.
Okay. So, Michaela.
I could answer because I have in my company a transfer from Excel to Google Sheet and it did not work really well because all functions and all programs and codes were given in an Excel sheet and no one has transferred it. So you need a smooth transfer. You need to convince the people and that it's easy to use and they have the same functionalities. That's the key.
Yeah, and you have to see the benefits. It's not just give them a tool and hope that it's working. You have to explain them what the benefits is. That's what I tried in my presentation to show you what's the problem and what's the solution. And if it's a problem for you, you might be interested in the solution. So it's a communication process.
Thanks a lot. So last round call here in the plenary. Is there any question anymore? I don't see anything. So I would love to say thank you to our panelists. Thanks again. And yeah, hopefully we have seen now a way forward, for example, for a smooth transformation from an analog to a digital workplace. An interesting session is now ending, and we have heard a lot about collaborative work and process changes in online standardization and online standardization tools. In my conclusion, as a recommendation for the future, we should develop new ways and means to make a wider use of open source technology and processes for standardization development and its frameworks. And our standards shall be created, I think, in the future online. That will be the future, that they will be produced and developed online. For example, with a collaborative text editor like this we have seen today, maybe with another one, but I think there will be one collaborative text editor. And let's come back to the questions from the beginning of our session. Is a simple way, a simple use of Word instead of paper and pen, the new digital workplace? Or is there also a need for changing our mindset necessary? I think we have heard already the answer to this. I think we have to transfer both, and I think only to transfer the pen and the paper into digital is not the solution. It would be an old-fashioned process for this. Tools can support our way forward to a digital workplace, but we have to keep in mind that we should not keep all our maybe sometimes old-fashioned processes like they were before in the analog world. Otherwise, we will miss a lot of opportunities of the new digital future we have. Thanks for today, and hopefully we see you tomorrow for the next WorkPoint 4.0 session about open and transparent communities, another really interesting thing. And now I want to hand over to Corinna again.
Thank you very much, Carsten, and thank you all for this interesting session. You gave me a very easy job now, just listening, but I found that very interesting. Ladies and gentlemen, as Carsten managed already, Tomorrow will be our next session here in this auditorium. So tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. we'll start here with another very interesting session, which is not on work 4.0 that's in the afternoon or at the end of the day, but we'll start with cultural engagement and affiliate development in the IEC. So that's probably a very interesting topic to many of you, and hope to see you then tomorrow morning. But before that, I hope to see you tonight at the opening ceremony of this general meeting here in Frankfurt, and it's out there at Festhalle, which is about a 3-minute walk from here. So doors open at 6:15, which is about in 45 minutes. So I think the program starts at 7, and I hope to see you all there. Have a great evening here in Frankfurt, and thank you so much for attending today, and see you tomorrow morning at 9. Thank you.
IEC General Meeting 2016. Connecting communities. Reinvent standardization.